Welcome to the Archaeoastronomy Database. This video will be a short tutorial on how to avoid one of the main mistakes I see being made when using Stellarium for archaeoastronomy investigations. To demonstrate this, we will select the sun and we will be opening up the date and time window, which I have down here in the lower right. You can see we have a date entered, May 16th of 2023. And we've already used the location window to set a location. And so often the summer solstice and the winter solstice are dates of interest when doing archaeoastronomy work. And it's natural to come down here and set the date to, let's say, the summer solstice, June 21st. And so from this site, we can see that the sun would be rising at this location. If we were to turn on our direction indicators, this is around the northeast, and more specifically, we could turn on our compass azimuth marks, and we could see that this is at about 51 degrees azimuth. And that works very well for modern investigations. However, what often is of interest for archaeoastronomy, of course, is to go into the past. So in Stellarium, you use astronomical dating system. So to go to, say, 3000 BC, you have to make that a negative number. All right, and we can see that the sun is rising now, not at 51 degrees as before, on June 21st, but at about 55. Now the difference here might seem to be because of the change in the Earth's axis, making the sun rise at a different position. But if you pay close attention, you'll see that if this is northeast, that this is due north. And so this is seeming to indicate that the sun at the summer solstice is rising not as far north as it did in modern times, and that doesn't make sense. The reason that this is happening is because June 21st, using the astronomical dating system, is not the summer solstice in 3000 BC. If we were to advance the days at each sunrise, we'd notice that the sun is continuing to get further and further to the north. Now we're into July. So at about July 18th, we'll see that the sun was rising at its maximum northerly position, this time at about 49.5 degrees of azimuth, as opposed to the 51 degrees that we had in modern times. So that's further north, as we would expect. Okay, so we can see that this date is not what we would expect to have. Now, doing that manually by advancing the sun till it reaches its maximum position would be a little bit tedious. And of course, you can look at the declination of the sun up here in the top left corner, and you can check as you're advancing and see if you reach the maximum declination. See, here we have 23.9, and then we reach 24 for a few days, and then back to 23.9. But again, that takes a little bit of time, and this is going to fluctuate a little bit with any particular time period that you're looking at. So the easiest way to do this is to use the plugin Archaeolines. In a previous video, I detailed how to install plugins, including this particular plugin. And so I'll link that in the top right corner here, and also in the description of the video. But to activate Archaeolines, you turn on this button right here, and you'll get these lines on the horizon, or where the sun, or any selected object, is rising on a particular day. And there's a dialogue where you can choose different options, such as to have the sun displaying, or the selected object. But often I'll leave that off and just use selected object so that whatever I click on is highlighted. And so here we've got the path where the sun is rising on this particular day. And then, because of the options that we have in the dialog menu, you can see that I've got equinox lines, solstice lines, and cross quarter lines. The cross-quarter lines we'll have to talk about a little bit more in another video, as they are calculated in a specific way. The equinox, of course, is just when the sun is at 0 degrees declination, and the solstices are the extreme. Southeastern rising point for the winter solstice, and northeastern for the summer solstice. So using these lines, we can very easily move the sun to the summer solstice of any period of time. So if we were going to go back to 2023, we'd see that moving back to June 21st would bring us onto that line. Now, of course, the sun doesn't move very much for several days around the solstice and is quite close to that line, for all intents and purposes. If I were to change just the year, you'd see by staying on June 21st from year to year, the sun will stay on that line. But if I were to move back century by century, the days start to float. In the 1700s, we're losing one day. I'm just going back 100 years at a time here. We're losing that day, and then you see, as soon as I go to 1500, I immediately lose about 10 days. And that's because the Gregorian calendar was instituted around that time, and so Stellarium uses the Gregorian dates from that time forward. From that time backward, it uses Julian dates, with a leap year inserted only every 4 years, with none of the extra Gregorian leap year rules. And so from this point backwards, the dates begin to float, and over time that starts to add up quite substantially. So you see now that we're at 1000, we're already getting completely off the solstice line. And even if we were to readjust the date back to the 21st, we'd stay on it for a little bit longer. But again, continuing back in time, we're going to start to lose, and it takes some time to start to get off. But now, about 1200 BC, June 21st is now not on the solstice position. And as we advance back further through 2000 BC and on to 3000 BC, we can see the problem that we had earlier with the sun at what we would assume to be the summer solstice without these changes in calendar. June 21st is not at the correct position. And so, with Archaeolines turned on, we can quickly advance until the sun is on the solstice line, and then we have our summer solstice. And the same works with our winter solstice. About 6 months later, we'll have that on the line. Now, the more you zoom in, the more refined you can get that position. You can see it starting to move. But even then, it's a little bit hard to tell the exact moment of solstice, if that's even necessary. But it will give you the position. If you're interested in the exact moment, you can, as I mentioned before, look for the maximum or minimum in the winter solstice case declination displayed here. And you can also go into sky and viewing options and go to markings. And if you turn on the ecliptic of date, you'll get this ecliptic line that the sun moves along throughout the year, and then you can turn on the equinoxes of date and the solstices of date. Be sure you're choosing the ones that say of date so that it changes with the date instead of being locked in to the J2000 position. And then you'll notice, as I change this, that there are small markings for where the solstices are. And this is an equinox marking, and you'll see it intersects the equinox line. And then if I move it back, the summer solstice marking on the ecliptic is intersecting the summer solstice line displayed in Archaeolines. So the sun moves along the ecliptic through all of these lines that represent the arc of the sun rising and setting on that day in the year. And so if we were to zoom in, we could watch for when the sun is closest to that mark. And we can even see that the mark is here and it's not quite centered on the sun. So we could, in theory, advance and find the exact moment of solstice, which might not be at the horizon or might even be when the sun is below the horizon. But you could move around until you found. Now it's pretty well centered here around midday. So, you've got to be careful when doing these investigations to make sure that you are actually looking at the sun positioned at the solstice and not just going by the dates that we'd expect. If we were to set this to December 21st, again, we'd see that we are not as far south as the solstice position should be, and we have to advance until we're on that line. And you can see that the solstice marking on the ecliptic is also that point. And so we'll have the sun rising and setting at the correct solstice positions for past archaeoastronomy investigations. Thanks for watching, and please like, subscribe, and support the Archaeoastronomy Database if you're in a position to do so. Your donations really help the work to go forward, and I've got a lot of projects in the works right now that I'd like to be able to bring to the community. So please, please donate if you can. Thanks again. Until next time.